This week on Maker Update, building your own submarine drone, Qualcomm buys Arduino, an animatronic virtual pet, a claptrap that claps back, and a mirror with a message. Hey, I'm Donald Bell, and this is Maker Update, our weekly show covering the latest DIY projects and tips from makers like you. I hope you're doing well. I've got a great show for you. Let's get started with the project of the week. From Max Imagination on YouTube, check out this remote-controlled submarine that includes an FPV camera feed. He's calling this project the ESP-DIVE, and as you might imagine, it's built around an ESP32 microcontroller. Two big things to appreciate about this project. First, if you head over to the video, which is linked down in the description, you'll find that absolutely every detail you need to recreate this project is documented and included. The CAD files, the code, the list of materials, PCB design files, it's all there. But the other thing you have to appreciate about this project is that designing an electromechanical device that lives underwater is super challenging. Water will always want to find a way in, and your mechanisms, your propulsion, your steering need to both interact with the water and be protected from it. On top of that, there's also the question of charging. I mean, you don't put a USB port on the outside of a submarine. What's less obvious, though, is that a Wi-Fi signal doesn't travel through water. And if the remote control and video feed from this thing are all relying on the ESP32's Wi-Fi capabilities, placing it underwater seems like an immediate deal breaker. His solution is to literally float a wired antenna from the submarine to the surface of the water, bringing the ESP32's Wi-Fi signal out into the open air. It's still technically a wirelessly operated device, it just happens to have a super long antenna. There are so many creative solutions on display here, from wireless charging to magnetically coupling motors and servos to external mechanisms, using syringes to adjust buoyancy. It's super clever, and how he gets it all to fit inside a watertight cylinder is just mind-boggling. Check it out. Now for some news. The Raspberry Pi Computer OS has been updated. It now uses Debian Linux version 13, also known as Trixie. Aside from a cosmetic polish of the desktop and icons, the notable change here is a new application called Control Center. This is a replacement for the individual preference applications, and it consolidates all those controls into a single window. If it's been a while since you've played around with the Raspberry Pi OS, this could be a nice excuse to reacquaint yourself. In Arduino news, the company has entered an agreement to join Qualcomm Technologies. In a press release from Qualcomm, they state that Arduino will retain its independent brand, tools, and mission while continuing to support a wide range of microcontrollers and microprocessors from multiple semiconductor providers. Only time will tell what impact this has on the Arduino ecosystem and the open source community around it. What we do know is that we have a new board to play with. This is the Arduino Uno Q. It was announced on Tuesday and includes a Qualcomm Dragon Wing processor with AI and graphic acceleration. You can learn more about the announcement and the new board using the link in the description. More projects. So many great projects this week, and each of these have aspects that I think could be adapted to some kind of Halloween build. First up, Will Cogley is back with a second swing at a face-tracking desktop companion robot. This one is far more sophisticated than the design we saw last month, both mechanically and in terms of interactivity. We're also treading further into Pokemon territory with this design, especially with the articulating ears and the moving mouth. Underneath the cute exterior is a very different mechanical approach than we've seen with his other designs. This time around, we're seeing a dense cluster of large 3D printed herringbone gears. We've also got new code from Will in the form of a dedicated servo class that handles servo easing, acceleration, speed, and position. The result is smoother animation and a better awareness of current servo positions and how to smoothly ease in and out of them. This project is built on a Raspberry Pi, giving it plenty of processing power in terms of servo management, but also enough power to run a local AI chatbot. This bit is still a work in progress, but it's exciting to think that someday soon we could have our own AI companion robots, hopefully not in a terrifying, privacy-destroying, end-of-humanity kind of way. If you want to be on the safe side, there's something to be said for building giant fake robots. Emily the engineer shows how she built this life-sized interactive statue of Claptrap from the video game Borderlands. By tossing out the possibility of making this a functional robot and instead prioritizing the look and sound of Claptrap, Emily and her team landed on a really fun showpiece here. And by building in a PIR sensor and audio playback system, anyone who walks past the statue will get a random selection of Claptrap-inspired lines. I definitely think you could adapt this feature to any number of Halloween decorations. And finally, on the Adafruit Learning System, a great tutorial from Erin St. Blaine on building a mirror with glowing secret messages. Think of this as somewhere between a smart mirror and a magic 8-ball. Erin took an old mirror and exchanged the old glass for two sheets of acrylic. One sheet had a two-way mirror finish, and the one behind it was clear. To make the words seem to magically appear behind the mirror, the clear layer of acrylic was etched with different messages. This way, when a section of acrylic was lit from the side, the message would appear and shine through the two-way mirror. In her full guide, Erin walks through the process of defining the different zones in the LED strip so that only one message plays at a time, as well as how to randomize the selection and how to trigger the system using a PIR motion sensor, just like Claptrap's. Now for some tips, there's a really interesting video from the Special Interest Group on Computer-Human Interaction. It demonstrates how it's possible to create solder-free PCBs. The trick here is to populate your board with components and then use a vacuform machine to pull a thin layer of plastic down on top of it and hold everything in a state of compression. The process is called ProForm or Thermoforming. I think it's fair to assume that the results won't be as durable or reliable as a board with soldered connections, but in a prototyping situation, I think there's a big upside to being able to reuse components over and over. From the Lost in Tech channel, there's a great overview of a type of 3D printer filament that's new to me called PEBA. This is a flexible filament similar to TPU, but with some different characteristics that you may find useful. For one, it's bouncy. So if you want an object that's both squishy and bouncy, this is probably your best bet. It also comes in a foaming formulation, often called PEBA Air, which takes on the look and feel of EVA foam. So for some cosplay applications where you need 3D printer-like detail or a high level of reproducibility, this could be a great option. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, check out this short from Sean Himmel on the basics of multi-threading your Arduino code project on ESP32 hardware. There are some classic strategies for creating Arduino code that can multitask beyond the main loop function. Still, there are some tricky constraints that can leave you wishing for an Arduino with two independent cores. The ESP32 includes an underlying framework that you can essentially use in this way. Check out Sean's video to learn more about multi-threading as well as his multi-part series on real-time operating systems. And that does it for this week's show. Be sure to subscribe, leave a thumbs up, leave a comment. A big thanks as always to DigiKey for making this show possible, and thank you for watching. I'll see you soon.